island of Haiti in the West Indies lured me to its shores because of tales of mystery and adventure. It is known as the Black Republic. When discovered by Columbus in 1492, it had a population of over 1 million souls, but quickly becoming a rendezvous for pirates of the Spanish Main, their cruelty reduced the population to a mere 60,000. This unhappy country of the blacks was long a battleground of intrigue for self-created kings and emperors, the last of whom, Henry Christophe, after expelling the Spanish, French, and English, established a black empire. The natives, who are the descendants of the people of the reign of Christophe, are an easygoing race. Their mode of living is simple, and slavery is no longer known since Haiti became a republic. Men now do the work once done by women. The sea now furnishes them with their main livelihood, and on their white, attractive docks, the trade of the city ebbs and flows. At the best hotel, I found a charming proprietress who spoke both French and English. Through her influence, I secured permission to photograph the treasure chest of the last so-called emperor. The chest now belongs to the descendant of a pirate chief. It is interesting to note that the lock of this chest was built on the principle of locks used on the gates of old castles in Spain. It gave me quite a thrill to see this historic piece of antiquity, realizing the treasure it must once have held. Spanish doubloons, bars of gold, a king's ransom. The key was a mighty affair of brass. Now just imagine carrying that on your key ring or around your neck. This is a unique photograph, the first ever taken of what was once the crown of a now extinct empire. It is made of solid gold, set with the rarest of jewels, and is worth a fortune. Bidding me au revoir, the lady seemed anxious I should return. You see, I was the only guest of the hotel. Starting on my way to find a guide to take me to the ruined castle of the Emperor Christophe, I came across this unusual sight. Women fishing with baskets. A rather novel method of following the pastime of Isaac Walton. In slow, methodical fashion, they take the basket and scoop up a few tiny fish, the small catch constituting their only meal for the day. I tried to attract their attention to inquire where I could find a guide, but with the usual native indifference so typical of these people, they left me strictly alone. Finally, two ladies, large on accommodation but rather scant on apparel, set out to try and locate a guide for me. Their principal mode of locomotion, as far as I could make out, was to travel about the streams in these dugouts, made from the trunks of trees. They either burn or hollow them out by endless toil and the most primitive of tools. Most of these dugouts are very old and are passed down from family to family as an heirloom. Much as a piece of old silver or a family painting would be passed down to you or me. It was quite impossible to get help here, as we met with a great deal of superstitious belief. The memory of a fearful past still influenced their simple lives. No one cared to visit the Palace of Sanssouci or the Fortress of La Ferrière, which was the late emperor's stronghold. But finally, from a nearby village, I obtained a guide, or rather I should say guide, because he brought all the family relations to show me the way. But only one horse, one of those lopsided yet sure-footed animals. By the way, horses were first brought to the island by the early Spanish colonists, about the year 1500. They don't need any moving vans here. When they are ready to travel, they just cram all their possessions on the family hack and are off. I don't think they forgot anything. And when it looked as though the horse could stand no more, the lady herself piled on top, just to sort of settle things comfortably for the horse. In this manner, we started off for the luxurious palace and the redoubtable fortress of the Black Emperor. Traveling over mist-covered mountains in the valley of Milo, a region that once saw suffering, cruelty, massacre, in its most awful form. So that this fortress, even after centuries, filled the natives with hatred. As we neared its frowning walls, my guides would go no farther, but they promised to await my return. As I rode on alone, La Ferrière looked down on me through the mist. It was this fortress that cost the lives of thousands of slaves to build. And as I climbed its steps, I realized that even though in ruin, the place still held its spell of power. These bronze cannon were dragged over the mountaintops by men suffering under the lash, who later were mowed down by the same weapons. It was somewhere in this dismal passageway that a doorway, now sealed, led to the dungeon, where the Black Emperor kept his prisoners without light or air, in a veritable tomb. This extraordinary self-styled monarch considered his subjects not only his slaves, but his enemies. Secretly, he would watch them at work through a blast telescope, and if any of them faltered for a moment, the roar of the cannon would quickly warn the countryside that someone had incurred their master's displeasure. Then I ascended to the battlements, of which they tell the most gruesome tale. This human monster, in order to impress a visiting French general with the obedience of his soldiers, ordered a company of his men to march forward upon this spot, and without a command to halt, let them go straight off the parapet into eternity. Leaving the frowning walls of La Ferrière, it was impossible to rid myself of the spell of its past, its inscrutable horror and cruelty. But there was still another interesting ruin. 20 miles away lay the castle of Sanssouci, where the Black Emperor held his court. Here he created a colored nobility with such titles as the Duke de Lemonade, the Marquis de Marmalade, the Baron de Bourbon. Fêtes of a splendor equal to many a European court were held here. Gorgeously gowned women, covered with diamonds and jewels. But under this thin veneer of culture lay dormant savagery, cruelty, and the ignorant superstitions of an almost barbaric race. Sanssouci was built on the grandeur of 15th century palaces, and Christophe, who knew no culture, gathered about him the best of European architects to carry out his emperor's dream. Many stories are told of how he treacherously did away with these men after they had served his purpose, so that they might never reveal the secrets of the palace. The grand stairway once overlooked a beautiful garden of French and Italian design and had a pool of silvery water fed by rippling streams. All over the place, you find ominous sentry boxes such as this, placed in odd nooks and corners about the palace grounds. True signs that his power was held only by sheer force. But time, the destroyer, always wins. In this very courtyard, Christophe, stricken with paralysis, anxious to keep his illness a secret from his enemies, called for his finest horse, and dressed in a gaudy uniform, was carried here. With superhuman strength, he tried to mount the animal, only to fall to the ground, helpless. When his subjects realized his weakness, they revolted. In this, his bedchamber, he heard his enemies drawing nearer and nearer. And as he stood by this window, watching them approach, he realized his reign was over. With a dying gesture of mock heroism, he placed the muzzle of a gun loaded with a silver bullet through his temple, and Henri Christophe, the last of the Haitian emperors, met his maker. In the center of this once royal courtyard, this mausoleum holds all that is left of this arrogant ruler, whose very name caused children to hide and men to tremble. He left behind him an epitaph, which reads, "I am born again from my ashes." For Christophe believed that even in death, his power would never end.